Good afternoon, you're with Proactive Investors. With me in the studio today, I've got Amir Butts and Ryan Lavelle, both from Lancor Scientific. Good afternoon, good to see you both.
Hi, Andrew.
Pleasure.
Amir, just first off, for those perhaps tuning in here for the first time, give us a quick introduction to Lancor Scientific, if you would.
Sure, Lancor Scientific is a company which is taking a very, very good cancer diagnostic screening technology and making it available to everyone, everywhere, all over the world.
And so what I mean, that sounds an incredibly big opportunity, but what makes you unique here? Are you alone in the space in doing so?
With the kind of value proposition or the product or service that Lancor is taking to market, yes, we're unique. But the sort of the real uniqueness comes in with the technology that we're using. Most people will understand with cancer, it is really good to pick it up early. The later you leave it before it gets caught, mm-hmm. the more difficult and complicated it becomes to actually treat you. And in fact, there is a point where it becomes starts to spread through your lymph or your blood vessels through the other parts of your body, when it's just more of a case of when and not if. And so the bit that so the Lancor proposition is looking to test people for cancer
right.
before they have symptoms, and where treatment is easier to provide. And so the uniqueness of what we have is the technology, which comes from a company called Tumortrace. It's a partner company, but we're also involved in that company too. And that technology is much cheaper than alternatives. It's more accurate than alternatives. And you get the results in what you could describe as real time. It's about 20 seconds, but in the world of cancer right. detection, that's pretty much real time. You're not waiting for 3 weeks to get your results. You get the results before you're dressed even. And then when you couple that with having all of that data that you capture through all the testing that you do globally in one sort of cancer registry, which is available in each country that the technology operates in, having that ability to then understand who you target to mm-hmm. invite, high-risk groups for early cancer detection, that's the uniqueness. And that, we think, is the strength of, if I may call it, the value proposition of helping find cancer early.
Well, we're going to look at the technology in a lot more detail in just a moment. But first off, Ryan, if I can bring you in here at this point, your role at Lancor Scientific, head of product delivery, tell me a little bit more about
Correct.
What you're tasked with here.
Okay. As head of product delivery, I'm responsible for the end-to-end delivery of the Lancor cancer screening platform technology stack. So that includes the Tumortrace device themselves, so building the devices, shipment of those devices, and integration of those devices into the cancer screening platform. Managing the partners involved in the IT delivery for the blockchain platform solution, and everything around that, so integration ultimately with health systems and the user interfaces and the applications that users will use for our tooling.
Well, tell me a bit more about why you reckon the blockchain is an important element in all this.
Yes, well, we get this question a lot, typically, of course, people say, well, why don't you just use any other database technology? It's a legitimate question, but when you look at the blockchain being a distributed ledger using cryptographic technology, provides the immutability and the verifiability around the data, which is essential for the type of data we're dealing with in this domain, with healthcare, obviously. This really enables the patients, our users, to rely on and trust the data they're seeing in the platform.
And you're, if I'm right in thinking here, your background is in banking?
That's correct.
Yeah, so what attracted you to Lancor?
I have a sort of 20-year career, successful career in investment banking technology solution delivery. Latterly focused very much on regulatory projects, no-fail projects, so quite large budgets, very, very serious projects. I joined Lancor about 6 weeks ago, to be honest, and I was very excited when I saw the proposition here. With the Tumortrace technology and the opportunity around the blockchain, I saw an opportunity for myself to really add value to this company and help them deliver this solution.
And speaking of that proposition and the opportunity, we've got a little a little video here which we can play, just outlining what's in store, the potential for Lancor Scientific.
If you detect cancer early enough, it's treatable. However, most people only go to their doctors once they've got symptoms. And unfortunately then, it's just a question of when, not if. Imagine a world where early detection of cancer was available to everybody, everywhere, regardless of how much they could afford. We're building a blockchain-based platform to beat cancer.
A scanning platform that has the possibility to allow an open and secure exchange on this level between the providers and the patient. This is definitely a game changer.
Cryptocurrencies are very widely perceived as suspect. They're untraceable, they're not regulated, they're scams. The Medici proposition seeks to address all of those issues by tying the currency to a real-world use.
Medici is a groundbreaking technology, and in the 20 years that I've worked in marketing, and especially digital and technology marketing for a range of larger organizations, I can see that this has the potential to really change lives.
So here's an opportunity for you not only to do good in the world, but also make a sound investment. Not just in the short term, but in the medium and long terms as well. Because we've got a very sound token economy, which will continue to stimulate demand beyond the short-term excitement.
It's going to be stringently regulated, and above all, it has a fundamentally ethical focus in increasing access to healthcare screening.
The pre-ICO is open now. All you need to do is to go to the website and register your email address to find out more.
Thanks. Well, I'm back here with Amir Butt and Ryan Lavelle from Lancor Scientific. Amir, of course, you and I, along with Paul Derbyshire, we were here in the studio roughly this time last week. Just bring us up to date on what's happened since. I know the white paper is now available for download.
It is, and like with all things, you have to do things the right way, and the white paper has been with the lawyers for their final approval, and we got that the back end of last week, and so it's now available on the website to download if you want to. And then also, because you know we're looking to attract the right kind of investors, all the KYC, know your customer, and anti-money laundering processes are now fully implemented. So when you go online, you fill in your data, and within minutes we'll get the results back to you, because we back off to a company who specializes in exactly right. That kind of stuff. And then there's the agreement as well. So investors who come on seed, they will have a contract which is tailored individually to them, and then so we're good to go. So the last week, you consider last week like a full dress rehearsal. Now we're all locked and loaded.
But of course, the seed round, it is open. How's it going?
Good. We've got, in fact, we've been debating how long to run the seed round for, because you don't want to take in too much money, because everybody who comes in early, of course, they get bonuses. And so there's a certain number of tokens that are available. So if you take too much money up front, then you exhaust your bonus, token bonus bank, as it were. So that is good. We're pleased.
And Ryan, of course, just going back to your role at Lancor Scientific, an incredibly, fair to say, ambitious task you've been given here. What makes you confident you can deliver on this?
Okay, a few things. First of all, I'm a very seasoned project program manager, used to operating in high pressure environments with complex IT change challenges. One of the first things I did when I joined Lancor was to introduce an IT partner that I'm very familiar with from prior engagements. They're world class, and they're already bringing to the table excellent leadership in terms of the design. I'm very happy to see the contribution of a gentleman called Martin Traverse, who's literally come up with a genius suggestion on how to model our blockchain solution. So, a combination of having the right IT partners and the right experience and governance processes around our IT delivery, I'm confident we can deliver this.
So some of your audience may be already know, the company's called Parker Fitzgerald, and they are a very, very strong systems supplier to the banking industry. So they do I wouldn't even begin to know the terms and the asset classes that they work in, but they are really, really, you know, sort of, so with, as well as Ryan's capabilities in terms of making sure that we program managing correctly and delivering on time, with a partner like Parker Fitzgerald, it means that the work we've got to do is not only going to be delivered on time, but it's going to be world class.
And as far as, let's talk about TumorTrace, the technology here.
Sure.
What cancers will you be screening for first?
Well, so it's already CE marked for cervical cancer.
Right.
And you could say, why did you start with cervical cancer? Well, a simple answer to that is that sample acquisition is a lot easier. You don't have to take a biopsy. Because we need a sample from the site where you suspect the cancer to be. So if it's breast cancer, you need a microbiopsy. So the amount of tissue we need is around anything between 1 to 2 cubic millimeters. And it's a very, very small sample. So we can do microbiopsies. So we started with cervical cancer in the first instance. And actually, in large parts of the world, cervical cancer is the biggest cancer killer for women. So it's also, you know, it's the right place to start in any case. So we, my chief scientist, Dr. Roland Schlesinger, with the work that we're doing in Austria, he's very, very bullish about being able to have the device enabled and CE marked for another 5 cancers by the end of 2019. So we're very quietly confident about that. He actually says it's within the next 12 months, but I'm extending that timeline to sort of by the end of 2019.
Is there any particular significance of him carrying out his work in Austria?
Graz is a biobank. A biobank is when you have a blood test done, for example. Those blood tests can either end up being disposed of when it's finished, or they can end up in a biobank for research purposes. And so a city in Austria called Graz has one of Europe's largest and therefore one of the world's best biobanks. So we're working very closely with them in the initial testing of the device's ability to detect that kind of cancer. Which incidentally, I ought to add, the reason our device is able to detect more than one cancer is because something happens in tissue as it progresses through its cancer, where the magnetic profile or the electromagnetic profile of it changes. And science has known this for decades. Mm. And the Professor Jura Corriger, his genius has been to develop a technique where you can detect this change without the need for expensive, big, bulky atomic force microscopes. So you will have seen in the device, it's like a microscope that sits on your desktop. And within that, we've got the capability of detecting these magnetic profile changes. And because it's that change is there, no matter where the cancer comes from, we can detect cervical cancer, colorectal cancer, prostate cancer, oral cancer, and these, we've already tested these, and we know we can. So with cervical cancer, we've done enough work to have a CE mark device, and the next stage is to do multi-site head-to-head trials, which we will be doing in Germany, Austria, and the UK.
These will be double blind, will they?
Yeah, that's right. And they'll be managed, not by us, they'll be managed by the Sigmund Freud University in Austria. And Professor Roland Schlesinger, he's a lecturer there, and that's where he practices, hence our connection to Austria.
You've got the CE mark, it's ready for rollout. Is there a particular need to do clinical trials, or is this?
Oh yeah, sure. A CE mark is a legal requirement, and you have to do a minimum amount of work just to justify your claims. Mm-hmm. I say minimum, the bar for what you need to do is high. It takes months and lots of effort and lots of capital to actually get CE marks. So I'm not diminishing that, but what I'm saying is that that's the legal requirement. But on top of that, then, like everybody else, clinicians are going to be far better swayed and persuaded by other clinicians who say, yes, I've tested this in my clinic over a matter of months, and these are the results I've gotten. And most all medical technologies have to go through that process to get the CE mark and then to do the head-to-head clinical trials against current best methods that are out there or current methods that are being used. And so that's the next phase of what we're involved in. And in parallel with that, we'll do the work, as I said earlier, with the other cancers.
Right. How long would you be looking at for the clinical trials?
So how many, how long it takes? Okay, so you have to do a study which is seen to be statistically significant. What that means is that if you have 20 million people in the population and only one every 10 years gets a particular kind of cancer, then the number of tests that you need to do obviously will be different than if you have 10 million people and half of those get that particular kind of cancer. So the population and the prevalence is important to understand how many sample sets you need to do. So we're doing a sample set which requires around about 4 to 6 months of work. However many samples you're looking to do, then it's a case of where are you collecting, how many clinics you're getting them from. Mm-hmm. If it's only one clinic, it could be a month of Sundays before you get all the data that you need. But because we're doing 4 in Germany, 2 in Austria, 3 in the UK, and perhaps 2 in India, we should be able to collect all the samples that we need relatively quickly in medical terms. 6 months, that's rapid.
Exactly. Well, yeah. It's probably quite timely to actually have a look at the bit of kit, the tumour trace in action. We got a clip earlier from...
So this is the current tumour trace device, which is CE marked for cervical cancer screening. It's a minimum viable product version, an MVP. We built 10 of these to test out in the marketplace, to test the strength of the components, the functionality of the user interface, etc., etc. And we've got a new version which is on the table for, which is a design for manufacture. But the functionality will be very, very similar. So let me just talk you through that. So in the screen here, it's set up to begin a test. You add a clinic reference number. I'm just going to put an arbitrary number in there. You put the age of the individual who is being tested. Again, this is just general demographic data we may be collecting. It's not relevant for the test itself. And then you click go. So the technology is able to detect any cancer because it tests for the magnetic signal of the sample that you present. And that magnetic signal is the same no matter which kind of cancer you're looking at. What changes is the noise that accompanies it. For example, samples from the cervix will have mucus, from the breast will have fatty tissue, from the colorectal area will have fecal matter, and they all represent noise. And what the algorithms do is strip the noise so you can just see the signal that underlies it, which indicates the cancer. In our case here, because this device is certified for cervical cancer testing, I'm just going to select cervical cancer and then what kind of sample it is. Well, it's a smear that we're doing as opposed to other types. It's it can be fixed, so with a paraffin spray, and stained where certain cells are highlighted, or a fresh sample. Well, let's just go for stained because that's normally what we're used to. And then you load up your slide. Now, I've just prepared one here for now. It's just a piece of paper. You load that up in here. You just close that up. And when you see the sample and it's there, you click start. What that does is initializes the camera and the light configuration that we have, and you start the analysis. Now, this is a minimum viable product, as I said, and the algorithms that we've implemented are written in R, which is a statistical programming language, and something called MATLAB, which is a collection of mathematical functions, which both of those are used in an academic or a research environment. And so we built them, as I said, you know, just for testing of the actual product itself. Therefore, they take a little bit of time now, but the analysis and the results, even using R and MATLAB, do come back within a minute or two. We have the new version, which is built for scalable manufacture. Is now the code has been written in C++, so it's much more rapid. In fact, we get the results in less than 2 seconds. We have to, in fact, they come back so fast, we have to put a pause in there of several seconds to allow the interaction of light and the biological matter for the quantum effects to take really effect. And so the results are coming back in just under 20 seconds. But in this version with a slower system, it can take a few minutes. So when the results come back, our technology can detect not only cancer but pre-cancer, and it can tell you what stage the cancer is at. And in this particular instance, the piece of paper that I put in there has the same or similar characteristics as if it was cancerous, and therefore what's come back is a classification of high risk. And that classification is enough for the doctor or the consultant to say, this is the results of the screening test. Now we need to do a diagnostic test, which then determines what kind of care pathway you should be on. So that's how the device works. And when you're ready, you can click and go back and start another test. It's as easy and quick and as much of a utility as that.
There we go, Tumour Trace in action for you. Back in the studio, of course, Amir Butts, Ryan Lavelle from Lancor Scientific. Amir, we've seen it there. Let's talk markets. Where are you targeting first off for Tumour Trace?
It's people who pay for the tests themselves. When you look at it from that point of view, you could actually sell this anywhere. We could sell it in the UK, even with cervical cancer. Because there are lots of private clinics where you can go and get these tests done. To sell into the NHS and, you know, sort of government institutions, there's a lot of work to be done, particularly so with cervical cancer, because we have an excellent cervical cancer screening program here already. And to displace all of the effort that's gone into making sure that's delivering good results would mean that we'd have to really prove the strength of what we're doing in terms of the health economic advantage, the money saved, etc. Now, we've done our own internal health economic analysis, but obviously the final one would be done by an external body like the Imperial College or NICE even. Mm. But our own internal, using the data from the NHS already, using what's called Markov modeling, which is a modeling techniques that you use to model these kinds of health outcomes, we're saving over the lifetime of a cervical cancer, somebody going through all the tests every 3 years in the NHS here in the UK of 170 million. We save 70,000 colposcopies. And there is something called the quality adjusted life years. We add 200,000 quality adjusted life years over the lifetime of the cohort. So we know that there is a strong value here. Even in the UK, but we're not expecting sales to come from the UK for at least in the publicly funded sector for at least another 2, 3, 4 years. However, in emerging markets, those countries are, as we speak, looking to roll out early detection screening, cancer screening programs. One of the big challenges they have financially and logistically is to, with the current methods, you know, you take a sample, you put it in a bottle, you send it to a laboratory, oncologist, the sample gets prepared, oncologists look at it through a microscope, and that's the pathway of the diagnostics with current technologies. Whereas our technology, you do it, you get the results there and then at the kind of accuracy levels which are more diagnostic grade than kind of screening, because there are, for cervical cancer, there are screening methods which aren't as accurate, and you can do it locally. But this is the advantage that a technology like Tumour Trace offers. And as they are thinking about how to set up their screening programs, a technology like Tumour Trace means they don't have to set up these infrastructures, contracts with laboratories, mass movement of population to clinics where you can take the device, you saw it, you can pick it up, you can take it to an urban setting or a rural setting and do the test, and the results are available for you there and then. And we're already in conversations with countries like India, in countries in Africa as well. In fact, we've gone from having no contact in a particular country to being compelled to host a cancer conference where the people attending would be senior government representatives in a matter of 2.5 months. We've had to pull back because it was moving too fast. Because you have to control, you have to do these things right and not be subject to political whim, as it were. So that's the kind of movement we're getting, that's the kind of traction we're getting. So we're confident, but we're not expecting any sales or revenue right. until towards the end of next year. And
But as the mayor says, Ryan, having to pull back because you're moving too quickly, it's a some might say a good problem to have.
Double-edged sword.
That's why it's good to have Ryan on board, because Ryan, you know, he's the one as with his expertise. Say, well, that maybe introducing risk.
Yeah, indeed. We have to keep an eye on the delivery risk at all times.
Right, and I suppose getting into those emerging markets helps generate those revenues earlier than you perhaps might expect from going into a developed market.
So traditionally, when you're developing med tech, sort of traditional investment mindsets in Europe are that you focus on Europe and the US because they're more lucrative markets. And then once you've done those, you take them out to other markets like India and China and so on. But to be honest with you, I think more and more companies now are looking at doing a double play where you're doing all the efficacy stuff, proving that the technology is real and it's not snake oil. Mm-hmm. Here in Europe or the US, because of the rigorous protocols that we have to follow here, whilst at the same time doing some market execution in emerging markets. So you learn, you prove the efficacy whilst learning about market possibilities, minimum viable product, getting customer feedback, that kind of stuff. And so that's the policy that we've been following and we will follow. And it's actually proving to be quite, we have, as I said, we have to be careful not to oversell too quick.
Well, let's turn our attention to the upcoming ICO and the Medici token. Tell me a bit about the Medici token here, Amir.
Sure. So I'm sure your listeners will know that there is, there is technology called blockchain, distributed ledger technology. Lots of financial solutions are being built upon it. What we're doing is using, as Ryan said earlier, the immutability, i.e. once the record's in there, you can't delete it, you can't hide the fact that it was in there, and the verifiability. In other words, if it's in there, I know it's in there. If I want it removed, I know it's removed. If it's changed, I know it's changed. If you've accessed it, I know you've accessed it. Those kinds of things on the blockchain mean that it lends itself really, really well to exactly this medical kind of solution, which is patient-centered. In other words, I have a test done, it's my data, I own it, and I say who gets to see it and who doesn't get to see it. And so one of the benefits of using some sort of blockchain implementation, and ours is based on the Ethereum blockchain,
right.
is that you can also, unless you're creating, if you create your own blockchain, you can have a coin, but we're using the Ethereum blockchain, so we have a token, which is sort of based on the ether. The value of our coin is not linked directly to the ether, by the way. The value is independent of it, as it were, but we're using the architecture of the Ethereum platform. Doing it that way means that, especially if we're designing it to be portable, in other words, if we want to put it onto another blockchain, because that is much more relevant to a medical setup, as there are lots of initiatives out there being worked upon. Some of those will be winners, and we'll partner with them if that's what we need to do, or we'll move over, we'll port it over to the, there's another blockchain called NEO, which is very, very fast and very good. We may port over to that, but we're building the architecture, we're designing it to be portable if we need it to be. And the Medici token is our token based on the And so we use that token. You can redeem that token when the blockchain and the technology, Tumor Trace Technologies, when Ryan has done his job and delivered the solution for us, you'll be able to redeem it for, you'll be able to take your Medici and spend the Medici to do it, to pay for a test, any cancer. And so, but one of the advantages of doing it that way, in fact,
You're better to answer.
What are some of these advantages, right?
Yeah, it would be.
Well, the first is the security you get from the cryptographic nature of the blockchain enables us to verify that a user walking into a clinic in one of these potentially emerging market economies is using a verified device, one of our own certified devices, a tumor trace device.
Right.
And that, of course, is very important. If you want to rely on the outcomes of those tests, something we as Lancor need to be sure that the data in our platform is coming through the right gateways and with the right technologies. This comes in effect for free as part of the blockchain.
Oh, very good. At this point, I've got to say we've had quite a few questions sent in through social media, people getting in touch,
right,
keen to put their questions to you. So just while we're on the topic, you're talking about Medici, these will be listed on an exchange, will they?
Yeah, so we intend to list the Medici on exchange. Obviously, we're going to be subject to their regulatory and their sort of selection processes, mm-hmm, but that's what we intend to do, yes.
So you say these aren't linked to Ether? The Medici tokens, no?
Yeah, they're not. So if the Ether goes up, it doesn't mean the Medici goes up.
So what's going to drive the value of Medici?
I think if you look at what the potential of the technology is globally, clearly that's going to be a value driver for any currency linked into solving a real problem. Which is looking for some sort of solution, but is the needs not being met. So when you look at the tumor trace technology coupled with the Lancor Scientific platform with a blockchain, having that technology available globally to everyone everywhere,
right,
in a trusted way, the potential for the company in terms of revenue is quite large. And that clearly is going to be a driver for the value of the coin, not just in the short term, but in the medium and long term as well. And the kind of activities that we've got planned, where we, as we roll out the technology sort of around the world, we anticipate that to be a continuous value driver for the token.
So just building on what Amir's saying, plenty of potential drivers here to affect the value of Medici here, Ryan.
Yes, of course. Well, and furthermore, the platform, when it's ready, will add other technologies in the future. So Tumor Trace, of course, at the moment, first partner, very exciting piece of technology, I'm sure we all agree. But there's a plethora of other diseases and other problems out there in the world, which a platform like this can be addressed to,
exactly,
to tackle. So there's infinite future potential for profit, I think, with something like this.
Another question sent in. Are these security or utility tokens?
Utility tokens.
For those not familiar with the difference, can you explain, Amir?
Sure. So securities are, you get shares with it, kind of thing. And a utility token is where you have the facility to use the token to access a particular product or service. The difference from a company point of view is the amount of regulatory hoops that you have to go through, how long it takes, what the effort is. And so markets about 18 months ago, some of our colleagues were suggesting we have a look at the ICO route to raise capital. And we shied away from it because of the dark web, it's money laundering, that kind of stuff. And not the kind of reputation you want associated with a company based on good science and proper tech, med tech. But because the markets are becoming much more regulatory and there's much more focus, I think that kind of pump and dump mentality and propositions are going to be few and far between, which is why I think the timing is right for a company like Lancor to raise capital through an ICO, being a genuine, legitimate company. And there are in the UK, there are two routes at the moment of you either being a utility or a security. And we've, through the advice of lawyers, this is why the white paper wasn't available until now, because the lawyers, their guidance is that we're a utility player and that's what we're going for.
And Ryan, you'd agree the time is right for companies to be looking at ICOs?
I think so. I think we're part of a class of companies that are really innovating and driving ahead with the blockchain solution. It's a new space and yeah, very exciting that we can leverage these type of technologies and the ICO process, tokenomics, to drive business value.
And Mia mentioned it a moment ago, the white paper, for those keen to get their hands on it and to take a look, where should they head to?
If you just go to medici.health, once that page loads up, there's a button which says download white paper, click on that, and then you should have that downloaded and available for you. We hope you enjoy it.
And of course, you'll be presenting this Thursday at Proactive one-to-one event at the Chesterfield?
Yeah, yes, looking forward to that very much. In fact, I presented there on your last one.
That's right, you did.
I think about a couple of months ago. Very enjoyable experience. We had lots of very good conversations from it since. And oddly enough, where I cite this quite a lot in terms of the inflection point of the value of cryptocurrency. That was my first experience of talking to people who, first the question was, statement was, love what you're doing. Secondly, what is blockchain? Thirdly, I mean, how do I do this?
Right.
And, you know, that was very revealing, because there's a big sort of desire for people to participate in this new asset class of cryptocurrencies, but they don't know how to do it and do it securely and safely.
Well, do you reckon in that time since you presented last, you're expecting people's understanding, those turning up, to possibly be slightly more advanced about what you're doing now?
Probably not, actually. But that's the challenge that we all take up. I think more and more people, there was enough of an interest in the last one 2 months ago where people were, because my advice to them was, please go away, look at what blockchain is, learn for yourself. It's important, because you need to, you know, if you want to invest, you need to understand what the dynamics are. So certainly with those group, I'm hoping they will have gone away and learned. But I think more and more people are looking into exactly what it is, how do you trade safely. And now if you go in the London Underground, you know, you've got eToro advertising how to exchange in, you know, how to trade in cryptocurrencies. So that it's becoming more main street and safer to trade, because it's becoming less pumping, you know, less scammy, as it were.
It's all become quite mainstream, as Amir was saying. Are you surprised at the momentum and the speed at which the whole blockchain cryptocurrency swing has crept up on us all?
Not at all. I think the conditions are ripe in the technology sector for this type of application to come. Not just in our field, in medical, in any aspect of business where you have transactions. There's a need for this security, the immutability aspect, you know, to really enable safe transacting. So I think, you know, we're just lucky to be in a field that we can apply it to something that is beneficial as medical.
Yeah, and actually in the financial sector, blockchain has been there for years. It's not new. Blockchain is not new in the financial sector, is it?
That's correct. Yeah. There's of course still, you know, quite a few resistance factors there, but there are a number of big initiatives in the world on clearing systems, and I'm aware of some projects from my last client with commodity financing, accelerating processes that take months to minutes. So it's, you know, it's something that's a real game changer.
It's revolutionary.
A game changer, revolutionary. I like it. Let's get back to the fundraise for a moment then, Amir.
Sure.
So what's your soft cap here? You're looking at?
5 million, we're talking US dollars.
US dollars, 5 million, right. Yeah. And your hard cap?
Is 50, yeah.
And that would allow you to, where are you looking at deploying
that? So if we raise the full amount, that will allow us to bring in multiple cancers, to build 10 multi-cancer diagnostic mobile units that will place around the world, and to put approximately 5,000 of these tumor trace devices as nodes on the blockchain,
right,
again throughout the world.
And I understand you've got, is it a special offer for people who get in early?
Yeah, so it's just a normal seed kind of investments. If you come in as proactive investors in the next week, you'll get a certain bonus. So if you, you know, so for every Medici that you buy, we'll give you an extra percentage bonus on the Medicis. So, yeah.
And the actual ICO you're looking at, am I right in thinking September?
Yeah, the full ICO launches in September, but there are stages beforehand, like we're in seed right now, and then there's something called the pre-ICO, where, again, you go out to a different kind of audience, and before the ICO, where you go global. In terms of your money raise.
Are you pretty encouraged with the the interest that you've seen so far?
We're quietly confident. We've had commitments which have already taken the soft cap off the table. So it's early stages, right, but we're confident.
So aside from the ICO then, Amir, what are you looking at tackling over the next 6 months or so? What are the priorities for Lancor Scientific?
Well, so other than the ICO, the bulk of the priorities actually sit on Ryan's shoulders for both beginning sort of the implementation of a screening management portal and the blockchain architecture, and then the clinical trial work that we need to do with the tumor trace technology.
That's right.
And if we don't deliver it, you should bring Ryan back in.
Big responsibilities there, Ryan.
It is, but I thrive on that, so I'm happy to take it. We're excited and we're busy with design at this stage. Technical white paper will be coming out early August, and I think that will give people very good insight into where we're going, right, with the technology. So that's something to look out for.
Certainly is. And aside from yourselves, of course, we spoke to Paul
Derbyshire
last week.
Yeah.
Outside of the three of you, you're confident you've got a top team in place, you've got the right people there?
Yeah, we're just, I think, if I can use the phrase, because this is such a, you know, you can have a job, a career, and something which is your magnum opus, you know, something which is worthy of doing. So you don't often get that kind of opportunity, and I think the opportunity has attracted. I'm very, very proud of the team that we've got. We've got about 12 people, highly capable, you know, sort of experts in their field, and the partners that we're working at, you know, sort of Parker Fitzgerald, really genuinely a top tier company, and proactive investors working with you guys. So we have a team that we're, you know, there are gaps. We're going to be supplementing the team as we move forward, but out of the gate, I think we've got a stellar team.
Brilliant.
Just so have a look at their profiles and you'll see what I mean.
Their profiles on your website.
Yeah, we're not part-time, we're full-time.
Full-time. Remind us, for people who want more information, where they should head, Amir?
So it's if you go to the white paper, which is on medici.health, and then look for the button, you'll see it called Download White Paper. And then if you go to the back of the white paper, you'll see some of the people that are working on the team.
And for people watching this, interested in that special offer for proactive investors, viewers, head to the Proactive Investors website, proactiveinvestors.co.uk, of course. Samir, Ryan, good to see you both. Thanks very much for coming in.
Pleasure.